Welcome to The Art of Thought. I'm your host, Kwaku Asafo-Ajay, and this is episode 4. In this episode, we're going to be talking about mental health. I'm joined with me here with Isack Chane here. Say hi.
Hello, everyone. My name is Isack Chane. Kwaku was actually my co-host on my podcast. It's on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/AquaBlack. Mm-hmm, we had a podcast called Aqua Black, and this is Kwaku's kind of own version of his podcast.
Yep. So, yeah, getting into it, we're going to go straight into it. For those who aren't used to this podcast pretty much is a general knowledge podcast. You don't really need to know too much. You just talking about what we're interested in. And this episode, I noticed the news stories that were into it, that were going on lately with Demi Lovato, where she just like she overdosed on some, you know, I think opioid or something like that. And I was like, wait, man,
what do you mean she overdosed on opioid?
I sent you the link, but Demi Lovato, in fact, I had to pull it back up myself. Demi Lovato, she was on the news recently. Where is it? It says, overdose. Demi Lovato, I'm looking on People magazine, people.com. Demi Lovato was rushed into Los Angeles hospital on Tuesday after suffering an apparent overdose and is now stable. A source close to the singer tells People. Oh my goodness. These little videos that show up. Don't click that. Don't click the People magazine. They're going to, unless you mute that little video that shows up. It's ridiculous. But yeah, she was put into, she was taken to the hospital because of an overdose. She did have an addiction in the past. Demi Lovato says here, Lovato has battled addiction, mental illness, and disordered eating for years. In 2010, she entered treatment where she was treated for bipolar disorder, bulimia, self-harm, and addiction. She relapsed after she left the treatment center, then entered a sober living facility for a year.
And that's I think that's the worst part about this whole situation. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I had no idea that she had overdosed.
Yeah, I didn't know until my mom, she listens every day, listens to the same things for soap operas, you know, Price is Right and stuff. And then the talk, you know, those four people, and they said it. And I was like, what? That's crazy. That's like in the past year alone, I've heard how many like things of mental health go on. Right. It's crazy.
And it's the worst part about this whole situation is she had been sober. And she was kind of the spokesperson of reaching sobriety and getting clean from your addiction. And to see someone be the spokesperson of change, like kind of a beacon of hope, to see her fall, it's kind of disheartening. And I can't even imagine how many people seen her as a role model and kind of looked up to her that were dealing with addiction in their life. And now they see her fall. It's like, I think society needs to change their whole perception on addiction, because it's this negative, you know, stereotypes and negative stigma around it. I think that if we start viewing it as a disease and we start focusing more efforts on researching and putting more efforts into mental health, that in the long run is going to help us as a society.
Yeah, and like it was very interesting. I'm trying to pull up the link here. It's very interesting in that, like, in the past, I think 2 years or so, we've had so many, like, celebrity problems with mental health stuff that we're hearing now. We didn't hear a lot of, at least, unless I didn't pay attention to it, but I didn't hear personally too many cases of so-and-so passing away because of this mental health thing, or so-and-so doing this. I didn't hear a lot of that, other than at Michael Jackson and some other celebrities. But I didn't hear a lot of that. And then it seems like this year alone, I've heard so many cases. Last year, I think near the end of the year, I heard a lot of cases. And it's just crazy because even us, you know, you being currently in college and me just finishing it, you know, we know a lot of people who have also been through those things or are going through those things currently.
Right, right. And, the opioid epidemic in the U.S. is horrible.
It's crazy,
You know, I've known people in my life that have been addicted, or, you know, I haven't known personally, you know, some I've known from friends, but
yeah,
it's weird. They struggle from an opioid addiction, and it started from like the smallest thing. Like it started from being hospitalized for an injury, and the doctor is giving them opioids as like pain relievers.
Oh yeah, was Michael Jackson his passing dealing like with that too, or was it a different thing?
Well, I think Michael, if I'm not mistaken, I think Michael Jackson died because of a fentanyl overdose, which wasn't.
Yeah. So that's what I'm saying. Is like,
I know the story of how he got hooked onto overdose, just because like a lot of the celebrities, they don't want to bring up.
Yeah, nobody wants to bring up that they're doing this. Right. But we're gonna say this real quick. We are not professionals or anything like that. We're just kind of talking about it. So take us with a grain of salt.
Yeah, we're not experts in the field at all.
Not even close.
We're not going to even give any, you know, diagnosis. Mm-mm. You know,
we're just reading off of these links. That's pretty much all we're doing, talking about it. But yeah, it's crazy. It's getting, you know, out there. You know, I had a friend. I don't even know what happened with him. And obviously, yeah, he passed away through some drug in general. And mm-hmm. I can tell that he was going through depression as well, because he changed his way of. You could tell speaking to him that he was changing his way of like doing things. He changed completely. I think his grandparents even saw a difference in him. I remember they said he wanted to go back to church randomly, and mm-hmm. he didn't go to church for like 5+ years. He said, "I want to go back to church. Let's have a cookout and stuff." And his grandparents were like, "What? Cookout? Church? What? You never talk about this."
Yeah.
So and yet when I was with him, you know, at his apartment, he just fall asleep when I come by, and I'm like, this dude never falls asleep because he's the one that invited me over. and he came to, you know, our school even before you ended up, you know, at the school. He came to our school to visit because he was bored or something like that. And I was like, okay, that's a 3-hour drive. That's a long drive to be randomly visiting for a day. He came in. Yeah, he came into my dorm. He said, what? Yeah.
I said, you guys were pretty close, too.
Yeah, we knew each other since fourth grade.
Yeah. So how, and, you know, one of the things I kind of wanted to understand was, yeah, how devastating was it for you to find out that a friend that you were so close with, you know, something tragic has happened to him? Because I think that's one of the worst things about this opioid crisis. Yeah. Is
that I'm not going to say he did opioid, any kind of opioid or anything like that, because I don't know. But I'm sure it had to do with some kind of drug in some way, but I'm not going to even say that because I don't even know either, you know? Right. So, but
what was kind of going through your mind when you,
I think I was obviously in school. So when I was in school, my brain is on a whole different spectrum. It's not even thinking about like, oh, I wonder what this person's doing back at home. It's pretty much, let me move your face. Cause like, for those of you, I don't record the video just yet, but like I'm looking at my friend here, and I'm like, I'm looking, my webcam's to my left, and he's on the far right of this giant screen. So I'm looking here, but the webcam's looking here, and it's just like it's looking to my left. It's some crazy thing. Let me move your window. But yeah, it was interesting because I was in my old place. My very first apartment, near where you are right now. And I think it was nighttime. I got a call from his grandparents who I didn't even have their number. I just got a random call and I just happened to pick it up, you know, cause I was like, nobody calls me from, you know, it's the 703 area, the DMV area. Nobody calls me from there that much. It's mostly 757. And so I was like, okay, let me pick it up. And it was like, oh, it's grandmother. Have you seen him? I'm not going to give his name, but have you seen him? Have you spoken to him at all? We haven't been able to reach him in a while. And I was like, no. Last time I saw him was, I think, when I was on break, when I came back up. And then she was like, oh, okay. Yeah, we talked to your mom, and she said she hasn't heard from him either. But we thought that maybe you, since a close friend, would know something. And I'm like, nope, haven't seen him for, like, since, I think, I don't know when she called. I think it was, like, October. Mm-hmm. Since August. I haven't seen him since August when I was getting ready to leave to school. And then a couple of days later, like, it didn't register in my head or anything, because I was like, oh, maybe he's just like that. I have a lot of friends who just don't answer their phone for long periods of time because they just don't feel like it or they're lazy. And so I was like, okay, it's whatever. Live on with my days. And then, like, a month or so later, I get a call from my mom. Not the grandmother, but my mom, and is like, oh yeah, so-and-so has passed away. Like, we just got word. I was like, what? So-and-so has passed away? From what? And I didn't say those exact words, but I was like, what? From what? And again, at that time, you know, when you first hear of any news of any kind of close passing or anything like that, it doesn't hit you for a while until you're able to process it. And you're like, you're sitting down, maybe eating dinner, and you're like, did that really just happen? What? I never would think this dude would pass away. And then, yeah, he passed away. And I was like, oh my gosh. And then it was just an interesting thing. I was like, what? And then it didn't hit till like December, because getting close to his birthday in January, where I was like, he passed away and his birthday was coming up, you know, in like 3 months. That's crazy.
Oh, yeah.
And nobody knew anything was up at all. Like, I knew, we saw a little bit, his grandparents and I, because of his strange, like, changes in style and doing things. He grew his hair out randomly, like J. Cole, where J. Cole had that phase where he was growing his hair out. He was growing his hair out. He's light-skinned, and he was growing his hair out, and he wasn't really, it didn't look like he was taking care of himself that much. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's not normal for him, because this guy always goes to our usual barbershop and gets haircuts. Haircut's always crisp and clean and everything.
Yeah, and that, I think that's one of the worst parts, is that as a friend, mm-hmm. when you know your friend is going through something, and you know that they're going through something, and they don't reach out. Mm-hmm. So it's like when a catastrophic event like that happens, your mind just naturally gravitates towards, you know, it's my fault. Like, I wish I would have done something.
Yeah, you kind of are thinking it that way.
Yeah, like you feel the sense of guilt. That's why, I don't know if you've seen now, they used to do it in high school. I remember when I went to my first high school, mm-hmm. they had these educational like / instructional videos of how to pick up on signs that your friend is going through something. Mm-hmm. So they had like a list of things like, you know, sudden and drastic change in mood. Mm-hmm. You notice that your friend is always tired, disinterest in a lot of things.
Yeah, changes of interest suddenly, yep.
Mm-hmm. And they, you know, they said that if you or a friend, you or a friend are going through things like that, that you should always reach out to someone for help.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think a part of it is like a lot of people are afraid of judgment. They're afraid mm-hmm. of, they're afraid of feeling like they're a burden or a nuisance, and because of that, they keep everything inside, and it's like this internal battle that they're going through that they never want to divulge with people. Mm-hmm. I think that's what the scariest thing is about, because, like, what do you do? You know, if you're a friend or a loved one, what do? You feel so powerless, and you feel like you feel this sudden rush of guilt. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that was the interesting thing, was that, like, I visited. In this part of the podcast, we're going to talk about that, but like, I visited his grandparents. I just drove over there when I moved back up here and I came back from New York. I just drove over there randomly. I didn't have their phone number. I didn't even have their address. I just knew the kind of area that it was and like where the street was. So I was like, okay, when I see these landmarks, I know that's their neighborhood. And then they happened to be home. I was lucky, so I didn't waste like a 20-minute drive. And I visited, and they didn't even expect me to visit, because there's no way I could have reached them. Mm-hmm. And so, because they don't have a home phone either, so they're not in any kind of public database. And so, like, when I did that, we were just chatting. I was supposed to go to the gym that day. I remember that very clearly. It was just, like, a month ago. I was supposed to go to the gym that day, and I was like, you know what? I'm going to go visit them first and then go to the gym. Talking to his grandma and his grandfather, we were just chatting in the living room that we never even sat at. When we were kids, that living room in their single family home, we never sat in that living room ever. That's the first time I sat in that chair. But yet I remember when they moved in there. And we were just chatting, and she was saying something like, because we played, a little backstory, we played a lot of, we played a lot with Legos, you know, Bionicle specifically. And then we played a lot with video games once we got past the toy phase. And then obviously, that's mostly the majority of the thing we did as kids. And as we grew up, obviously, we didn't really touch those things too much. Maybe just video games occasionally, but we went out mostly. And I could tell, like, when I was speaking to his grandparents, she asked me this crazy question. She was like, do you think that you and him as kids, we let you guys play too many video games? And I guess in her brain, she was thinking maybe video games was the reason of why this passing suddenly happened. I was like, in my brain, I don't personally think video games are a reason for that. He didn't have that kind of imagination to be like, I'm going to just go out and do things. No. So video games to me wasn't the thing, but it was just an interesting thing. I visited them. I was just chatting with them just to catch up because someone you know you were close to is gone. That's for anyone out there. Just because anyone's gone doesn't mean you're out of their family completely. Like, if you know them that well and you knew their parents, doesn't mean you just ignore talking to the parents now that they're out of the picture. It's like, no, that's messed up. You know?
They probably need it the most.
You said what?
I said they probably need it the most, like that comfort.
Yeah.
To talk.
And I was the closest one. He was literally, my mom said, he was literally like, you know, I have two other brothers. My mom was like, he's literally pretty much like, when you say brother from another mother, he's literally like that, like not blood, but he's literally like a brother to everyone in this house here. And then to his sister that he has, his younger sister, at this point, I'm pretty much like a brother, even though we don't talk 90% of the time, 95% of the time. But how long I knew them for, since fourth grade, so I don't even know what year that was, pretty much like another sibling. At that point, it was no longer like just friends. It was just like we were literally family at this point.
Right. And I think that, you know, if you couldn't understand what he's going through,
mm-hmm.
then you can understand why he might have had like apprehension or might have hesitated to tell you what was going on. But mm-hmm. you've dealt with your own.
Yeah. My own demons. Yes.
Yeah. So you can probably relate to a lot of what he's feeling, you know, the anxiety, the sadness. So it's like,
and I know his story. I'm just not going in depth with it, obviously, on purpose, mm-hmm. but I know his story pretty well. I think I know all the stages of what happened at this point pretty right. well, because I know him like that, even probably to an extent of how much, a little more than even his parents know, because you as your parents' son, As messed up as it is, we don't always speak out to our parents like, I feel really this or that. We don't speak out like that. We kind of just try to keep strong no matter what to our parents. Don't really let them in on what's going on, even though you hear everywhere, TV and everywhere. They're like, let your parents know. But we kind of don't, and I'm sure he did the same. He kind of probably was trying to inch closer to it
right.
By saying, let's go back to doing the old things.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't really, he probably didn't really be like, yeah, there's some, I feel really weird nowadays. I'm sure he did not do any of that, because otherwise they would have known signs and they would have tried to help immediately, you know? So mm-hmm. that's usually the case it goes, is like you said, you don't let in on it. And so then it becomes too late and then something happens and then it's just like, it's over. So it's kind of a rough thing to hear, you know. And that's kind of why I came up with the podcast topic today, because I was like, I was going to do a different one today. No one needs to know what it was, but I was going to do a different one today, and then I was like, I'm hearing all these stories recently, just this week, you know, Demi Lovato, for instance, with her story. We have Chester Bennington with his story. Kid Cudi just released a new album, and he's finally good, too. We have Eminem with his story. We have, I'm saying a lot of rappers because that's what I listen to. You said what?
Anthony Bourdain.
Oh, yeah. Anthony Bourdain was just this past summer alone. Or this summer alone. And then we have, I had another person in my brain, but I forgot. But we have a lot of cases. Oh, yeah. Kanye West revealing he's actually diagnosed bipolar as well.
I liked how he came out with the news of that, because, there's this, I don't know if you've noticed the YouTube drama with Fousey too, but
mm-hmm.
he's like, when Kanye West released his album, he said how bipolar was his super, like being bipolar.
His superpower, yeah.
Yeah, so it kind of like knocked down this like, this negative stigma around people with that were diagnosed with bipolar. Mm-hmm. And it's not that, it's like, okay, I have bipolar, I need to ignore this. No, it was like, I have bipolar, I'm trying to get treated, but I don't see it as mm-hmm. this like this cancerous disease on my personality. It sucks, but I'm going to try to view it in a positive light. And I love the
That's
fact
good, that, you know. It's good. He's not saying bipolar is depression, because bipolar and depression are two different things. He's just saying but I know as a celebrity, as people, I said as a celebrity. As celebrities often say, and you hear them all mostly from celebrities, because as private as they try to be, celebrities are the ones that are followed the most. So, like, just about every celebrity, I'm sure, suffers from some form of depression because of how paparazzi is. Is it raining?
Well, I mean, I wouldn't
imagine. It's pouring outside. My goodness.
I wouldn't imagine every celebrity. Probably.
Most celebrities. Yeah. Because it's just, once you become fame, you know, the famous history to me.
Yeah, what is it? Like, I don't get that.
It's the thing is this. I listen to a lot of music, obviously, and with the music I listen to, you often hear a lot of, I'm not even going to go through that. It's just going to be that when you become famous, I want to say problems, but any kind of things that going on in your life become amplified. So if you have, for instance, Demi Lovato, an addiction of any sort.
Right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
The people you meet in that industry, things become amplified. If you have problems with depression of some sort, because you try to be private about it, but as a celebrity it's hard to become private, especially that big of a celebrity. Mm-hmm. Things become amplified, and when things become amplified, they go out of control. And when they get out of control, you know, you're afraid all the news outlets are going to talk about you and stuff. You don't get help because you're afraid someone's going to speak about it, I'm sure. And then things like this happen. Everything becomes amplified.
That's an interesting point that you bring up. I was listening to a podcast about that, and they mentioned how people that had addictions that weren't celebrities and that weren't rich, what happens is their addictions worsens and worsens until they have no money, and that's kind of like a rock bottom that they hit.
And even Kanye West, I'm sure obviously he's not going to be broke anytime soon. He's good.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
But he talked about it in his album Gay, where he was like, I think he said something on the lines of, he like, people thought he was going to go broke soon or something like that. Or he thought he was going to go, his family was like going to go broke soon based on what he was doing. I don't know the story of Kanye because I don't follow him, but I just know of his music, and it's an interesting story, you know?
Yeah. And he brings up a good point. It's like when you have no money, your addiction worsens until you have no money, and then you hit this rock bottom. You get this sense of like self-realization, and you try to change your life.
Yeah.
Right. But when you're famous and you have money, it's fueling your addiction. You know, it's making everything be okay. Mm-hmm. You're not going to go broke. You have this like what seems like endless amounts of money to fuel your horrible habit. Mm-hmm. The habit progressively gets worse until it meets the ultimatum of death.
Mm-hmm. And that's the problem.
Yeah, and it sucks, and it's scary.
It's super scary. You know, I hear a lot of people, they're like, I don't want to be famous. Oh, sorry to cut you off. Go ahead.
Especially for the families and friends of the people that see this go down. Because it feels like, holy cow, like they have like limitless amounts of money. Mm-hmm. If they want, they could hide their addiction from family members. And now you're tasked with what feels like the duty of like, how do we help? You know, what do you do to help?
Yeah. It's crazy. Yeah. Like you often hear people say they want to be famous, but then people who are famous, they're like, no, you don't. Mm-hmm. But then people who are not famous, to those people saying that who are famous, they're like, you're just saying that because you're famous. And it's like, I'm sure I've talked to you about this. I'm like, I personally never want to be famous. I don't mind being well known, but I don't want to be famous. Because when you're famous, like we've been saying, it seems like things get amplified. Things get out of control real quick. Because you don't have your privacy. If you're well known, you still have your privacy. You know, one of my inspirations for like podcasting, Leo Laporte, you know, he's not famous. He's just well known. You know, for what he does, but he's not famous. Bill Gates can walk around and not get paparazzi constantly taking pictures of him.
I guess it's fame is subjective, though. You know, so your viewpoint of fame could differ from the next person, and whatever viewpoint you have on fame, you do have to recognize that there are tons of negatives that come with it. The privacy you mentioned.
Yeah, the money is just one little thing that kind of is a plus, definitely. You know, you don't have to worry about having to, where is this next money going to go to be able to buy my next whatever?
Or connections.
But it's just, and you get connections, but it's like, but with those things comes other things, you know, comes downfalls as well. So it's just like, there's plus and minuses for it all. And it sucks. Demi Lovato, if she was like you and I, you know, if she wasn't well-known like you and I or anything like that, the news outlets wouldn't be covering this because, like, oh, it happens to everyone. Because a figure, you know, a role model is having these problems as well. They're like, oh man, yeah, we need to talk about this and get it out there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but if it was just some random well known person like a podcaster that I follow or like maybe a person not like a YouTuber or something like that, not like a giant YouTuber, but like just an average YouTuber, like, you know, the person I wanted to come on the show, they wouldn't cover it. So that's where I marked like the difference. It's like, will you get covered from People Magazine? If you will not get covered from People Magazine for your problem, you're probably just well known or not at all.
Oh, so that's kind of how you
example is like People Magazine, yeah, from a news outlet. If you don't get covered from like a major news outlet, other than local news where they do cover local issues, but like they don't cover it all every day. Otherwise, your news would be filled with just people like, so-and-so went to this, so-and-so went to this, so-and-so got arrested. It'd just be covered, right? You know? So it's crazy.
Well, I kind of want to veer a bit off topic. I don't know for you, did you have any more topics?
Yeah, I have other people other things I'm going to talk about, but we can just jump into this real quick. Go ahead.
No, you can continue. I was just going to veer off. Continue.
No, I mean, the way this podcast works is we're not going to spend 20 minutes off topic. You can go off for like a minute or two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I was just going to segue into the next part.
Right. I was just going to mention like any battles that you've personally went through.
Oh, I've been through battles.
Maybe not so addiction, but maybe just, you know, mental battles that you've gone through that you feel like you've somewhat overcome or you've went through the worst of it.
I've been through battles. You know that I've been through battles. In fact, my channel that's now defunct, I even uploaded one of the battles. And I think...
I've seen that.
I think in that video, I don't know, was that before or after he passed away? I'm not even sure. When I was in a dorm during that video. For those of you who don't know, I had an old channel. It's gone through many names, so I can't even mention what the name is because it doesn't really matter. But I made a video like twice. Couldn't upload it until like that current video, and it's now delisted. That was just talking about my battles, and it was crazy. I'm not going to go in depth, but you know, I'm talking about this topic not because I'm just a person who is just interested in it, like I'm studying it or something like that. I didn't study that. I'm talking about it because I've witnessed it. I've been through some of it. It isn't easy, you know, even some of it, you know, with depression stuff and all that stuff. You know, family part of it doesn't even know. Like, I have just my sister probably who knows some of it, and that's it. And she doesn't even live here. So it's just an interesting thing, you know. I've been through it. It's rough. It's rough, hard to get through.
And I think that's what makes this podcast so interesting, is that I think everyone has had their moments, but you've had particularly horrible.
Yes. And I've had friends while I was going through it, also going through it at the same time.
Right. So, you know, you've had exposure to this. Yeah. So I think it's a bit that your understanding of what's going on is a bit deeper.
Yeah.
Than someone else that can't relate.
That's why I wanted to do the topic, was because I wanted to do the, you know, dichotomy of just, you know, I've been through it, or, you know, I even currently probably still do go through it, probably unconsciously. And I know people who have gone through it. I know I've read up on it. I have talked to people on it. I've seen it on TV. You've seen it. Everyone has seen it on TV.
And then, by the way,
it's a crazy thing.
By the way, for the people that are kind of confused, because I know that we keep referring to this, like, it. We keep saying a lot of it. I went through it, and I know it sounds like we're being vague, but what we're essentially talking about is struggles.
Yeah.
What we're saying is struggles with mental health.
Yeah.
You've had. Do you want to go into detail and kind of divulge on that?
I'm not gonna go into too much detail. I'm just gonna be surface level and just be like, I say it a lot because I don't want to specify onto like people have gone through suicide or people have gone through depression, people are bipolar, people are this. It is like a general term to summarize all of it together. So, I've no friends, for instance, who have like, you know, they've cut themselves wrist-wise, so they wore long sleeves for a while. You know, we've witnessed that stuff before. I'm sure all of us have. I've had cousins who have almost attempted suicide. I've had problems in my family with things like that. It's a crazy thing that, like, getting older, you know, I'm only 24 right now. Getting older, I'm noticing it more and more. Whether I did back in the day, I just didn't care about it. You know, I tried to just shrug it off. But I'm noticing it more and more. I'm more aware of it now. So, it's interesting. And with that, the perfect segue. There's a game that I played. I sent you the link of it. There's a game that I played called The Awesome Adventures of Captain Spirit. It's made by Don't Nod Entertainment. It's a game. And I feel like this camera is like crooked. It doesn't matter. And it's about a kid who it's got some darkness deep inside it, like the link from Sci-Fi says, the darkness hiding within the awesome adventures of Captain Spirit. And the darkness inside is Don't Nod Entertainment, for those who don't know, those who don't play games and things like that, I highly recommend this. You can even download one of their games on your mobile phone. Life is Strange. It's on phones. And it's on computer and every console everywhere.
Is Sci-Fi like this? Why is there?
No, Sci-Fi just wrote on it. I don't know why.
Oh, Sci-Fi. Yeah. Is it The Wire? Oh, yeah, I think I see it.
Yeah. Sci-Fi Wire. Oh. Yeah. And, like, it's an interesting thing. I played it last night. Like, I started around, like, 11. It's apparently only a two-hour game. It's a demo for their next big project, Life is Strange 2, that comes out in September. And it's about a kid named, is his name Chris? Chris Erickson, I think. And he's his mom passed away, got hit by a car, got in a car accident, and now it's just him and his dad in a house. And I'm gonna try not to spoil it, but it's pretty much at that point spoiled. But it's still a very good experience. It's a game you got to experience, so whatever I say doesn't even matter. I'm not gonna go into details, but like, there's a lot of clues that come up in the game. And when you watch anyone's video walkthrough on it, or if when you play it yourself, you see all these little signs. He's very imaginative. The kid, I don't know how old he is. I must have not been paying attention to how old he was, but he's a kid. He's a child.
Right.
And his dad is an alcoholic. His dad is also a drug user. I think it's just cigarettes. I'm sure that's what the game does. But. And you notice hints around the house that he has, that he's with his dad, that his dad doesn't take care of things very well. He seems to be putting the blame of his mother's passing on the kid.
Oh, okay.
So it's about parental abuse, but in a child. So the dad is pushing all the blame to the child, and the dad is not taking care. Like, there's one of the tasks. There's only like six tasks in the game. One of the tasks is like, turn on the hot water heater because it's snowing outside. It's Christmas time, actually, in the game. Turn on the hot water heater. That simple task that a dad should do. Mm-hmm. It is thundering. Jeez. That simple task that a dad should do, the dad didn't do it. The child had to do it. That's one of your tasks to do that you can choose to do. You don't have to do them all at all. You don't have to do any of them. You can just jump straight to the end if you want. And him being so young, he's afraid of the dark. And the hot water heater is in a room that's pitch black. I guess he doesn't know where the light switch is, or I don't know. Well, you have to open a door and leave it open, but because it's a game, they don't let you leave the door open. And so his way of doing things, if you watch the trailer or anything like that, is the kid is so imaginative. Like, he puts on an alias, Captain Spirit. It all seems like an illusion to me. Oh my goodness, do you hear this?
No, what is that?
Oh, this microphone is covering up everything. That was a thunder. That was lightning.
Oh, so for the listeners at home, tell them that, like, you're in the Virginia area, more towards
Northern Virginia,
right? And it's like raining like crazy outside there. Oh, by the way, here, it's not raining at all.
Yeah, it's insane.
It's just cloudy.
It's not fair. It's been raining for 2 weeks here, but it's crazy. The game, I had to talk about it because it does still kind of relate in a way, because it's messed up. That the kid, apparently, yes, the kid will return in Life is Strange 2. His story will continue. So you'll get to go more in depth of it, not just a 2-hour demo. But the dad is putting all the blame of his mother's passing on the kid. The kid has an overactive imagination, like a super imagination. Man, it is crazy.
Oh, yeah, I heard the thunder. Heard that in the background.
Yeah, it's rumbling. If the power goes out, you know, we'll cut it together. But yeah, the kid is just, he has an active imagination, and like one of the parts is you got a snowman outside that the kid made. And
do you know who the developers of this game? Because this sounds like a movie that I've seen, or a TV show. Or
it's Don't Nod Entertainment, but published by Square Enix.
Oh, Square Enix. Yeah, I like that.
Don't Nod made it, though. And, like, you know, they're very story-based in what they do. You know, Tomb Raider and everything. Mm-hmm. And it's crazy. The dad is doing all this stuff. The kid was supposed to go out to go to some place. I forgot. And the dad's like, hold on, I want to watch the game. The dad is a jock. More of a jock in high school, and his mom was like an artist. Oh my goodness, it's crazy. But the kid was supposed to go out, and the dad wanted to watch a game because he was a jock in high school, and his mom was an artist throughout, and very active in their school community and everything like that. And somehow they got together and they got married and had a kid, which was Chris. Mm-hmm. And then the mother gets hit on this crossroad, some street, I forgot what the street was, gets hit on some street, I guess, near their house,
right?
And they get, the kid's brain doesn't know how to process. He was too young when his mom passed. They give you all the dates and stuff in the game and all these clues, and it's about to rumble again. And like, I'm trying to go service level, try not to like go in depth on purpose. So I'm trying to figure it out as I speak. And yeah, like,
it sounds like you're going a bit in depth, but
I'm trying not to go in too in depth. I don't want, because there's, even what I'm saying is not much, because you have to experience it yourself, all the clues and all the interesting stuff. But yeah, when the mom gets killed by the car, you see all these notes around the house and around everywhere, and things that, you know, when you live in your house right now, if any of you are, you know, adults with kids or anything like that, and like, you, it is crazy outside. It's like a war is happening. But if you have kids or anything like that, or you've known people that, you know, one parent, mother or father, is subliminally, not subliminally, but it's like moderate abuse, you know, to the kid, mental abuse. Even some physical, actually, in the game. It's crazy.
I think that it's weird that you mentioned that. Mm-hmm. I never experienced that on a scale of that magnitude. Mm-hmm. But I think both of you and I, having African parents, I think that we've experienced
the mental side.
Yeah, like a handful of those moments where our parents would indirectly blame us for things that we had no control over. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, you know, I was on the phone with you and we were arguing, and I parked in a spot that I couldn't park, and now I have this $50, $80 ticket that I got to pay, and it's your fault.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know, I used to get that a lot.
Oh, I haven't gotten that ever. But
oh,
yeah.
My goodness. My dad used to do that to me all the time. Like,
he's like, we shouldn't have gone to Toys R Us. It's like, I just wanted to get this new toy.
I would ask him, hey, can you pick me up some food from the, you know, gas station or something? Can you pick me up a snack? Oh, you see, I went to pick you up a snack from the gas station.
Now there's traffic. Now I have to waste gas.
Now I'm late to work. Uh-huh. It was like this indirect blame on me for things that I had no control over.
Yeah.
That maybe might have played a factor, but at the end of the day, it's not my fault that you went out of the house.
Yeah, and actually executed the thing. At the same time, it's like if you just say no to your kid all the time, it's still kind of abuse because you're like, man, dad just straight up does not care. You know, that's how you feel as a kid. As a young kid, you're like, I want to get Twizzler or Skittles. When you're like friends, I remember calling my mom when I was at the store, when she was at the store when I was like five or something like that. I told my dad or sister or someone to call my mom. And I was like, hey, can you get me Skittles? Oh my goodness. That was just a flash flood warning on my phone.
What is going on in your
It's location? Crazy what's going on right now.
I'm watching.
You hearing the floor is shaking. Flash flood warning in this area until 9:15 p.m. Avoid flood areas. My street is straight downhill, and there's gutters everywhere, so it's fine on the street. But yeah, so I remember having to call my mom, and I was like, "Hey, when you get to the checkout, can you get me Starburst or some kind of candy, you know, small little packs?" And she'd be like, "No, I don't want to spend that money." And meanwhile, it's only like
$1.
It's like a dollar or less. I think back then, those days, early 2000s, it was like 70 something cents or less, 60 cents. And I was like, dang. And I knew at some point in my life, I was like, I'm not even gonna bother calling her because I know she's gonna say no. So it was just like, you know, but his thing is deeper, obviously. Chris's thing, his name is Charles, because literally on your hand, he's got dark bruises on his hand from his dad. And I didn't know what it was. At first, I didn't register it. And I was like, maybe he just burned himself from playing, you know, doing something with the game. But no, he literally burned himself. Not burned himself. He literally, it was physical abuse. You don't see it in the game. It's shown, like, in the opening scene, literally. But you don't nothing like that actually happens in the game. The crazy dichotomy that I read on a lot of, like, it is like insane. Hopefully we don't have to cut this short, but like,
right,
the crazy thing that I read in a lot of articles online was that the crazy thing I saw online is like the game's darker side, like you saw on sci-fi. And basically, it's not that the dad is completely irresponsible. The dad is not completely irresponsible. There are some things in the game that the kid, you know, wants or, you know, asks the dad. And the dad is like, straight up, like, sure, let's go do it. You want to go to a thing. He's trying. You can tell the dad is trying to be good, you know, to cope really well. But in, I guess, drinking and in just indirectly, he's blaming it on the kid. So it's not that he just straight up sucks, the dude, you know. He's trying.
And I think the developers did an amazing job, because that is kind of an accurate representation of real life. You're not going to have a dad or abusive parents that are 24/7 abusive. Mm-hmm. You'll have moments where they're nice. That's why, have you ever heard of Stockholm Syndrome?
Yeah. Explain to them what it is, though, just surface level.
Well, Stockholm Syndrome is basically this psychological condition where you begin to develop a bond with your captor. Mm-hmm. So if you're in an abusive situation or you're in an abusive relationship, what happens is you'll justify all the bad things that your partner or your whoever you're in a relationship with is doing, because you see them from this different lens, I guess you can say. So you start to justify all the bad actions that they're doing. And I think that children with abusive parents, they'll still want to stay in that environment.
That's how he is. He wants to stay in the environment. He's too young to know anything else. He doesn't have anywhere to go. And I mean, technically he does in a way when you play the game, but you can't go anywhere. The crazy thing is, it's a demo and they keep you stuck within the grounds of the house. Even though you have neighbors around and stuff, and you have numbers written down for phone numbers to talk to, like his dad wrote down three phone numbers that he should always know. One of it's like a pizza delivery person. I guess it's so that way he can have food if his dad can't, you know, which is crazy smart. You know, the dad knows the stuff he should do.
Right.
It's just that, like you said, it's the outlashes. That's what's destroys his brain. And with his active imagination, all the characters that he does, you know, you as Captain Spirit, Spirit's kind of like a allusion to like courage in a way. It's like, I'm gonna go through this. I'm gonna survive. it feels like that's what Captain Spirit is.
I see what you're saying. So yeah. He kind of still has that resolve to keep going.
Yeah, and that's what Captain Spirit is. Yeah, yeah.
Did you find yourself relating at all to any elements of the game?
Not really. It was just more like, yeah, I have heard people, friends, and stuff like that that have, not really gone through it, but I've had we know of cases, you know, we hear them all the time. And so I was like, this is a very interesting game because one, it's a developer, Don't Not Entertainment, and Square Enix that they're good at doing these kind of things. You know, they're good at creating these kind of stories that you can relate to. One of their originals, the one that came before this, was Life is Strange itself. It's from Chloe and her friend, something else, and it deals with suicide in that game, and like lost friendships to the point where your friend changes, and it just craziness happens. But then they throw a spin on it too.
Oh, so they try to tackle these socially, mm-hmm. these social phenomena in like in an understanding way.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know what's crazy is, I don't know about you, but I feel like I've seen a resurgence of, not a resurgence, I'll just say more of a huge spark of. Oh, now it's starting to rain in my place a lot now. Mm. But I've seen a huge spark of TV shows and movies and games gearing more and more towards like suicide. Like you see 13 Reasons Why.
What's that game?
A lot of mental instability. Like you see 13 Reasons Why.
Detroit Become Human. It's with androids, but at the same time, it's still some related stuff.
Right. And I don't know if you... So one day I was on Facebook, right? And I found this thing called Facebook Watch. They do free television shows. Mm-hmm. There's this television show called 5 Point. They do mm-hmm. like 8-minute episodes, and it's on Facebook. It's completely free. Mm-hmm. And this show centers around these characters that are all going through their own battles. Yeah. But one day this just horrible, horrible event happened on school grounds where someone took their life.
Jeez. But, similarly, I can't even say the word. Go ahead.
But here's the crazy thing. It takes that one moment, that entire day, but has multiple episodes where it gives you everyone else's point of view.
Oh, that's cool.
Of like, and you'll have like, you know, redundant elements of like, oh, that happened in this character's timeline. Oh, this also happened in that same timeline. And you just see it from five different perspectives. You see it from five different eyes. And I love that element of it you've seen, it's not something new, right? You've seen writers write about five different points, but for me, it was kind of refreshing to see it all happen on one day. Mm-hmm. So we'll take one specific event and look at five different characters' eyes. And it was like a high school. I was dealing with these huge like issues. And I don't know. I seen more and more television shows geared more towards like friends that are dealing with suicide or dealing with mental health.
Yeah, it's I don't know. It's crazy. Like, I don't know whether, again, we're just being more aware now mm-hmm. or whether it's really just a thing that's becoming more and more literally aware, publicly aware, and accepted in a way.
What else happened?
Flash flood aired.
Like, do you know if, like, suicide rates have been going up in the U.S. or...
I don't know.
Stability?
I don't know. I didn't look that up. I'm kind of curious, actually. Let me see.
Yeah, now
just sent me another flash flood warning.
I'm wondering if that has been going up or just exposure to things like that have been going up.
Let me look at a trusted source.
With social media and everything.
I don't know if I can trust 90% of these sources, but I'm seeing that based off of NPR.org, New York Times, Washington Post, NBC News, and the CDC, actually, Center for Disease Control, suicide rates are up 30% since 1999. That was June 7, 2018. Actually, all of these things were posted the same day.
30%.
Yeah. So it's up 30% since 1999, is what they say on their headline. I didn't read it. I didn't read the article yet, obviously, but that's their headline.
That's mind-boggling. That is insane.
in one of the lowest ones places.
We're so, wow.
Yeah, the more populated areas are have the lowest suicide rates. The less populated areas like Idaho, Utah, Wisconsin, and South Dakota, North Dakota, stuff like that, where nobody talks about, those have the highest suicide rates. And then Nevada, for some reason, it's like a 1% increase, according to the map, roughly.
Wow, that's mind-boggling. I guess, well, you know what they say? They say that, I don't know, you know, I can't pull up a specific statistic, or I can't pull up a scholarly reviewed source citing this, but I can say I've heard that social interactions, friends, and humor play a huge role into increasing mental health, like having better mental health. Like there's a direct correlation with having friends and socializing in real life and having that, you know, that sense of humor helps mental health a lot. I know for me, it definitely did. Like,
yeah,
my sense of humor.
I can tell that even for me, myself too, it's like the worse my life feels, the more I try to like laugh it, you know, try to be like, that's what people tend to think, like, you know, especially in those days, those darker days for me, where people can't, nobody, they don't know about it, but they're like, except for my few friends, they didn't notice anything wrong, obviously, but it's like, if I'm always kind of hysterical, there's gotta be some kind of problem, you know?
Right.
I'm not, no human being is always, not even Dave Chappelle is always, like, laughing or joking. Kevin Hart, he's not always joking and stuff like that. No comedian is 100% joking all the time. So, right.
And that's a good point that you bring up. I think a lot of comedians and a lot of people that have dark humor use the humor to hide up what's really going
or
on.
Or to even use cope. That as a,
Yeah, and oh heck yeah, man! Humor is an amazing coping mechanism. It can really alleviate a lot of stuff, like being able to laugh at something and not take it so serious.
You loosen up a little bit. That's what they say.
Yeah, you loosen up, makes you feel better, man. Yeah. It's like,
so that's why I'm like,
surrounding yourself with friends, it can really help.
Yeah, that's why I'm like, it's another, and I'm saying it again, is like, this topic, I really want to talk about it, because it's like, I know people, we all know people, I've been through some of it, just the stories you're hearing, the headlines, and then now, just surface level, obviously, take it with a grain of salt. Whether you like NBC News or not, they and a lot of other networks are all saying suicide rates are up, and even the CDC says it too. So since 1999, which is a long time, but it's crazy, you know, we're hearing about it more in the news. I guess the news, if I didn't pay attention to the news back in the day and I am now magically or something like that, or maybe I have been paying attention equally, or maybe the news is just getting more and more comfortable with talking about it now. Now that more and more celebrities, for instance, are dealing with it. So it's a crazy, crazy thing that we're seeing here. Let me look at this one other link.
And I'd love for us to get at a point where we take really big active steps into trying to better mental health in the U.S. Because we see, it feels like when you deal with mental health, the most viable solution is, let me throw some pills at you, you know, like, oh,
yeah, that's a problem. It's like, there's the one thing I told you, I think like months ago.
Not to say that's bad. Not to say
Sometimes it works for people. Really, some other people, they go too far.
Right.
But like, sometimes I've told you, it's like, we're seeing a lot more of it, you know, in everywhere. And to become more aware, like you said, tell them what you told me. I don't know if we were doing it before we started recording, but like, I think you said in high school, I don't know if you said it during this thing, 'cause it's been like an hour almost. You said you learned something in high school. You had to take some kind of class, something like that, about being more aware of that stuff. Tell them what you told me.
Right, right. Yeah, I was just telling you how going into my freshman year, when I was at my high school, they segmented everyone into like classrooms, you know, based on, I don't know how they based it on. I think it was probably alphabetical order, but they put everyone in separate classrooms. It was kind of, we called it home ec. It's kind of home ec. I don't know if you you guys would know what that is, but it's
home
just
economics. They teach you about life.
Yeah, they teach you about
all life living
stuff.
Yeah.
That first, I would say first day or two of school, they put on, they're like, hey, you know, if you know anybody that's dealing with anything or that struggles with anything, you can feel free to always talk to us. And it was kind of like this very positive
support
message.
System.
And then support system. And then they put a video on to make us watch that said what signs to look for if you feel like your friend is going through something. And it said, you know, loss of appetite, loss of interest, tired all the time. And then it said, like, you know, if you yourself are going through depression or anxiety or suicidal thoughts, call this hotline and reach out to your friends, reach out to the school counselor. So it was like, I see, I like that, right? It's positive, it's good. It might lead, and it's a preventative measure to stop someone from taking their life, and it's making the students more aware. But I would love to see the U.S. adopt just
more of that kind of thing.
Yeah, bigger pushes for educating people on mental health and kind of getting rid of that stigma that if you have mental health, you're weak. You know, if you're at your job and you're not performing well and you're not productive because you're suffering from anxiety or the stress is eating away at you, that you're just not built for that job. You're just weak. And I've seen that a lot in the labor force.
Like, yeah, I've seen that. Because they don't want, because it's like, you're on business time. I don't care what's wrong with you. You're wasting my money.
Right.
At the same time, if your worker, if your coworker, for instance, because even if you're a CEO, technically the workers underneath you are still coworkers. Your coworker, if your coworker passes away under business time, that's hard on that's going to hurt your business too. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe they're having problems, so they're slowing down your work pace, you know. But if you help them, then it goes back up. But if you hear that so-and-so passed away and then so-and-so's boss did not do anything about it, kind of had ideas but didn't do anything about it, your job, your business is almost ruined because, like, oh, these people don't care.
Well, they're kind of disconnected from, like, a lot of CEOs, they're disconnected from lower level management.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I'm talking bigger business, like smaller businesses.
You know, you bring up an interesting point, and that's something that I kind of wanted to touch on and that I was kind of going to do a project on, was increasing employee satisfaction in the workplace. And I touched on, you know, I was looking at a lot of different viable options or routes how to increase employee satisfaction, but it's so important to have your employees satisfied, especially high-level employees like senior executive management, because of the fact that it can lead to better productivity. So not only would it make your company more productive, it'll just make it'll look amazing to the public, to PR. It just does wonders for your company to have employees that are satisfied. And people are like, well, you know, how do you accomplish that? You can accomplish that through just small things, maybe not making such a strict. So one of the biggest gripes that people have with going to work or working is the commute. They say that if their commute to work is negative, that it can negatively impact their day. So by making the commute to work easier, you make the employee more satisfied. So they say one of the ways that you can do this is by having a flexible time to come in. So if work starts at 9 a.m. and someone comes in at 9:10, someone comes in at 9:15, you don't take such aggressive measures.
Like, why were you late for 10 minutes? 10 minutes of work time that you wasted.
Yeah, you don't take such aggressive measures to punish them. Instead, you're a bit more flexible when it comes to
that. That's what happens in a lot of nursing jobs.
Right.
They just you're supposed to come in at, say, my mom goes to work at, supposed to be at work by 3. She leaves at 2:30. Her commute's probably like 45 minutes. She left today at 2:30-ish. But they don't mind that because, again, nursing jobs, they know about mental health already. That's what they do. Right. And so they're like, oh, you come in 10 minutes after, that's fine. 15 minutes, just let us know if you're going to be late for one. And that's it. But no big deal.
I think that that's a positive thing to reinforce. And some people argue, well, you're just reinforcing everybody coming late to work.
Why
come at 9 a.m. even if I live two blocks down when everybody's coming in at 9:15? It's like, and people are going to come even later and later. It's like, no, we're not saying that you completely not punish people for coming in late. We're just saying you have a bit more flexibility.
If they give you a reason, if it's a logical reason, obviously, like coming in late for class too. Remember, your teachers back in the day, they used to be like, why are you late for class every day? You know, or whatever it is. And
right.
Some teachers are like, no, you're going to get bad grade, because they start scheduling assignments to be the first walk-in of class. They schedule an assignment, and if you miss it because you're always late 10 minutes, then you're screwed. But and other teachers start understanding.
Right. And it plays, you know, it plays a huge role in mental health in general, because that's kind of what the topic is about, right? It's mental health. One, I read somewhere that it's kind of like a, I wouldn't say a rule, but it's kind of like an unspoken thing in entrepreneurship, that one of the fundamental rules is always pay yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Always pay yourself, because you need to recognize that you're a worker. Even if you have your own company, even if you have your own business, you need to stop and enjoy the fruits of your labor, or else you're just grinding yourself to the bone. You're just like, you know, grinding to the bone, and you have no fruits of your labor to enjoy. You have no satisfaction, and that's going to keep you disinterested and dismotivated, and it could lead to worse mental health. So
yeah,
sometimes you got to treat yourself.
Like, you see, back when I was, you know, at our school over there, I was like, I'd randomly be like Sushi King or like Volcano Sushi, or I'd just be at some random place that is way too expensive for what I should afford. But yet I do it every once in a while, because I'm like, I'm busy working, I'm busy going to class, I'm busy trying to finish school. That's even, people say your final semester of school, college, is supposed to be your simplest. Even though I was only taking, you know, two classes, you still get the stress of like, I gotta make sure these are perfect. So then you're like, all right, I can't stress myself by doing too much all the time and never enjoying myself in this final time. So let me try to mellow out, just relax, and try to relax at least, and just do it, you know, finish strong.
And that was your specific, that was my
experience of it.
Yeah, that was your experience of senior year. Everyone's experience is different, of course. But
some people do have a similar one where it's like, I need to make sure this final, because like for me, in your final semester, a lot of places you have to do capstone courses, and those are like your capstone assignments and stuff, where you got to do like a major project at the end. Luckily, I didn't have to do that, but because that semester is just how the major was structured, we did something else. But I have a friend who, she was doing computer science, kind of on the side, but she's doing computer science. She finished with it, obviously. And she was like working late to like 2 a.m. in one of our buildings. I don't know what it was called. I think it's Dragus. And that's far away from her dorm in Ireland. No, Virginia House. So that's a walk, as you know. If you guys have ever heard of Old Dominion University, you'll know how far away these things are from each other. Walking, no skateboard, no nothing. And the type of area we're into. And so she's doing that stuff late, almost every day. Even weekends some. And then she's doing internship on the weekend, or not, volunteering, like professional volunteering on the weekends downtown.
Oh, wow.
And so she literally has no chill. You hear her, she's like, oh, no, I'm fine. But it's like, you are not fine. I know for a fact you are tired. You want to rest. You want to watch some anime. You want to do something. But you're busy having to code this app with your team, who some of them are unresponsive.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so it's just like, you know, it's kind of on the side when I'm saying this, but it's all related in a way. But finishing up, because we're past an hour now, it's an interesting thing. The little things even that add up to the bigger thing, you know, whether it's Chris Erickson from the Adventures of Captain Spirit, with his dad and his mom and him, all the problems when his mom passed away. And his dad did, or just people we know in general, that have gone through it. Celebrities like crazy lately are hearing more and more about that are going through it. A lot of them are recovering, luckily. I think Demi is gonna do pretty well, because you know she's got a lot of support. I'm pretty sure she's gonna be good. Because at least it's the early stage for her. Not early stage. It's people caught onto it early for her versus like Anthony Bourdain, where you didn't hear of any problems until he just was gone.
Well, no, you knew he did deal with or struggle with drug addiction in his past, and he was very public about that.
Oh, he was?
Yeah.
Maybe I just didn't follow it, but like it was just crazy because like my mom, for instance, and my dad, they go to work every day. They don't have time to watch the news all the time, and it's just like all they saw was I think most people do know Anthony Bourdain. A lot of celebrities are going through it, but for Demi Lovato, it was just like, oh, okay, now we know that she overdosed. It wasn't that she overdosed and she's in a severe, what is it called? She's in the ER, severe, whatever, and she's like on life support. You know, it wasn't that crazy stage right there. It could get there, it could stop. You know, she's with her family. She's good, actually. I think she's out of the hospital now. But like with Anthony Bourdain, I didn't hear of anything until it was just like so and so is gone. I was like, what? And it just jumped straight to that point. They just said he is in the life support. He's in ER. He is gone. No, he wasn't even in the ER. He was just gone.
Yeah.
He didn't die in the hospital. He died in his house.
Yeah, it was vice.
It was crazy.
It wasn't drug overdose, and that's the thing.
Yeah, so. It wasn't. It was something way worse to me. I think it was more physical. It was himself. So it's just crazy, but...
But the thing is... You know, the thing is like when the situation with Demi Lovato, I think what's interesting the most out of all that is I'm curious as to what made her do it again, because she had been sober for such a long time.
So here's the thing. I was watching, as much people would probably not want me to reference this show, but the talk is what I heard this from, that show, the talk on Channel 9, I think, in this area. And, like, they were saying that, because they're all celebrities, so they know, and they know celebrities, so they know more firsthand experience on it. And Demi Lovato, she had the problems in the past.
Right.
Even before she was famous, too.
She had been sober for a long time.
She was been sober for a long time, and she relapsed. Yeah. Relapsing can happen any time. Suddenly, your brain is just like, let me do this again. And then you just start.
I don't know.
I don't know the deep story, because I don't know Demi Lovato personally, and I don't know... I'm only taking what news tells me, and right. So I don't know the deep thing. I don't want to go assume things, but all I know is that, you know, from even personal family stuff and like that, relapsing could just happen out of nowhere. You're just like, maybe I need this thing today. And then next thing you know, you just keep doing it. And then you're just, next thing you know, you're whatever's happening to you. It just happens randomly. Eminem, same thing happened to him.
Yeah, but he's, what, 10 years sober?
He's good now. He's really good now. Kid Cudi, too. He's good for, like, 5 years now. He's sober.
I hope.
Yeah, I hope currently still, too. We haven't heard from him in a while, but, yeah. It's just scary. But, yeah, you got anything last to say?
Yeah, I just want to say, everyone, you know, to everyone out there that this has been an amazing podcast that, you know, thank you for Quaco for reaching out to me. I know it has been hectic for both him and I. Well, yep. Mainly me, because I had went to Schaumburg, Illinois. So it was a brand new state, never been there. So flying back was a bit hard, but I'm glad Quaco kept in touch. You told me that you had this podcast, I think.
3 weeks ago?
Yeah, 3 weeks ago. And you've already uploaded, what, like two, three episodes?
Three uploads at once every week.
Yeah, so you've stayed somewhat consistent. I mean, pretty consistent so far.
100% so far, yeah.
Yeah, so when you told me about the podcast, I was like, wow, you know, I'm glad that you're still creating stuff and you're still going on that creative path. I know you had a YouTube channel that you didn't want to continue, so I was like, man, I really hope you find a creative outlet, and you have done that. So it was amazing to be a part of this podcast. Especially, you know, coming over from Aqua Black, you're part of that, and you've helped tremendously out with Aqua Black, the channel, the brand name, the podcast. So, you know, it was good. It was really fun to be on this podcast.
Cool. Do you have any projects you're working on that you want to let people know about?
Projects, yes. So, I'm going to be focusing. Well, I wouldn't say a lot. I'm thinking of doing a high production quality segment of my podcast. For you, for those of you that don't know, my podcast is called Aqua Black. That's AQUABLACK. Mm-hmm. I'm sure Quake was used to hearing that from when we used to co-host together.
I'll put it in the description too, as I usually do for all the show notes.
Right. So, you know, I'm thinking of doing a high production quality segment on that. But other than that, in the YouTube channel, nothing too big.
Okay. I think
I'll focus maybe teach myself how to learn stock mm-hmm. investment. But other than that, no. How about you?
Well, before you even talk about me, because this is all for you. Where can they find you? Social media.
Well, you can find me on Instagram at MJ_Slam. That's where I post comedy skits. I have fun. It's just mm-hmm. kind of like a fun thing that I do. You can also find me on YouTube, youtube.com/AquaBlack. That's youtube.com/AQUABLACK. The podcast that I have is under the same name.
Okay. And this show here, The Art of Thought, you can find it pretty much on almost every network you can think of at this point. It's coming to YouTube soon once I get the video part set up and good to go. But you can find it on SoundCloud, The Art of Thought, just how you say it and how you spell it. You can also find it on Stitcher Radio, same name. You can also find it on Google Play Music. You can find it on TuneIn Radio, Spotify, not yet, but iTunes is also pending. iTunes is coming soon, Apple Podcast. It'll all be under the same name, but you can find it on all those other networks currently. And then this current episode should be uploaded later on today. So... this is The Art of Thought. This is episode 4. This is mental health. So hopefully you guys have a nice day. And let me know what you guys think. And email me to theartofthoughtofficial@gmail.com. Let me know any show titles, anything that you want me to talk about. And I'll see what I can do. All right. Take care, everybody.